workshop, and I was truly blessed by it. He broke it down real plain. So I'm gonna launch into it. So the first thing he talked about was, number one, there is a protocol to God's presence. There's a protocol to God's presence. And those of you who are on boards or work in any type of organization probably know what protocol means. But the meaning of protocol is an official procedure or system of rules governing affairs of state or diplomatic occasion. How many of you are familiar with Robert's Rules of Order? So protocol, I know you do. So protocol is basically an order. There is an order to God's presence. And the gist of what he is talking about is not just singing songs, but ushering in the presence of the Holy Spirit whenever we are ministering. So he talked about that there is a protocol to entering into the presence of the Holy Spirit. So the first scripture I'm going to read talks about the wrong way to do it. And I'm going to ask my Bible reader, that's you, Dexter, to read. Read! You know how they do? Read! You can't see it. Just read it. Read. You got to read it with profundity.
Then David consulted with the captains of thousands and hundreds,
yes,
and with every leader.
Uh-huh.
And David said to all the assembly of Israel, if it seems good to you and if it is of the Lord, our God, let us send out our brethren everywhere who are left in the land of Israel, and with them the priests and Levites who are in the cities and their common lands.
Wait. Go back up there. What is it?
If it seems good to you.
If it seems good to you. Did it say that it seemed good to God?
If it seems good to you.
To you. Did they ask God? Did they? No. David said, you know, y'all think that's a good idea? I think it's a good idea. Let's do it. That's basically what he said. I think it's a good idea. Let's do it. Let's just do it because it seemed like a good idea at the time. Read.
And if it is of the Lord our God, let us send out to our brethren everywhere who are left in the land of Israel, and with them to the priests and Levites who are in their cities and in their common lands, that they may gather together to us, and let us bring the ark of God back to us, for we have not inquired at it since the day.
Stop right there. Okay, how many of y'all know about the Ark of the Covenant? I'll give y'all a brief synopsis. The Ark of the Covenant was a place where the children of Israel worshiped God when they were in the wilderness. This was a holy place. And everybody, what? Couldn't what?
Carry.
Everybody couldn't carry it. Everybody couldn't touch it. Okay? So this was a very sacred place. It was a sacred thing. And he had them, well, anyway, read. Keep going.
Then all the assembly said that they who do so for the things we was right in the eyes of all the people.
Keep going.
So they carried the Ark of God on a new cart from the house of Abinadab, and Uzzah and Ahio drove the cart. Then David and all Israel played music before God with their might, with singing on harps and string instruments and tambourines, on cymbals and with trumpets. And when they came to Chaldun's threshing floor, Uzzah put out his hand to hold the ark, for the oxen stumbled.
He did what?
He put out his hand to keep it from falling.
He did what to the ark?
He put out his hand to touch it to keep it from falling.
And then what happened to Uzzah?
Then the anger of the Lord was aroused against Uzzah, and he struck him because he put his hand to the ark, and he died there before God.
Died dead. Yes. So they had good intentions. They had really good intentions. David, he didn't mean no harm. He wanted to do something for God. He wanted to bring the Ark of the Covenant back. First of all, it had been a long time since they worshiped at the Ark. So it's like, okay, let's worship. Let's do this. They sang songs. They had the best of intentions, but they went about it the wrong way. They didn't follow the procedure on how to handle the Ark. And we can't go into all that, but there were certain procedures. One of which is that you had to be of a certain tribe to touch the Ark, and Uzzah wasn't, and now Uzzah is dead. They hadn't worshipped the Ark for a long time, so they forgot the proper way to handle it. Another point that Minister Lawrence made was that Uzzah's very name meant own strength. So they were doing this based on their own strengths or their own actions, what they wanted to do, but not really being led by God. They were just led by an idea. And having the desire does not negate God's protocol. So when we're worshiping, we may have the desire to sing, we may have the desire to do it, but if we're not doing it for God, if we're not doing it with the right heart, it just negates the whole thing. So their plan, I'm touching on what Pastor says a lot. Their plan was efficient, but it was not effective. So the point I'm trying to make with this point is when we try to worship God through our own gifts, minus God's presence, they were minus God. He wasn't in that idea anywhere. We are passing on ourselves to the congregation and not His presence. So when we're up there singing, and like Portia was saying, that we're not doing the things we need to be doing, we're passing on us. We're not passing on Him. And so that's part of the protocol for God's presence. So now we're going to talk about the right way. I just talked to y'all about the wrong way. Now we're going to read a scripture about the right way. Rita, read.
David built houses for himself in the city of David, and he prepared a place for the Ark of God.
Wait a minute, stop right there. So later David, he went back, he repented, and the Lord forgave him. And in this passage of scripture, which is Chronicles 15, he gets it right. I'm sorry.
And pitched the tent for it. Then David said, "No one may carry the Ark of God but the Levites, for the Lord has chosen them to carry the Ark of God and to minister before him forever." And David gathered all of Israel together to Jerusalem to bring up the Ark of the Lord to its place, which he had prepared for it.
Okay, so the first thing David did was he prepared a place for the Ark of God. And that's what we need to do before we get up to worship. We need to prepare a place in our hearts for God to reside. We have to prepare our temple in whatever manner we need to prepare, in terms of prayer, in terms of our own personal worship. We have to prepare a place for God to reside in order to get into His presence. Portia also touched on this. We get up and sing, and we're doing all this in public. And we're singing, and we're waving our hands, and we look real spiritual. That's our public relationship with God. Well, how do we have a public relationship with God if we don't have a private relationship with God? That's just like me and my husband. Like, if we all in front of y'all, you know, laughing and hugging on each other, and when we at home, we don't even speak. And I mean, I hate to say it, but I know couples like that. We don't even like each other. Like, they married, they don't even like each other. You know, I like him. But here's the thing. How many people know you can tell with those couples when it's for show? I'm just going to say it. There was a time, I'm not going to say who it is, but y'all figure it out. I watched the Food Network. There was a couple who I used to enjoy watching. It was a husband and wife. And they were just, "Oh, baby, so good to me. I love you so much." They divorced now. And I was always like, they doing too much. Like, it didn't seem genuine. Overkill, yeah. It didn't seem genuine. And I mean, and Lord forgive me that they are divorced. But if you, it's obvious. If you don't have that private relationship, that intimacy, it shows. So we can't have a public relationship with God. We don't have a private one. The next part, we must, this piggybacks on that, must be in fellowship with God in order to minister effectively. So the next part, and I'm just going to lift up this one verse. It said, no one may carry the ark of God but the Levites, for the Lord has chosen them to carry the ark of God and to minister before him forever. And I told you, I've been in music ministry a long time, and I've heard people say, oh, I sing, I'm a Levite. And they get this puffed up attitude because they feel like, well, since they can sing, they're a Levite. Levi means adhered or joined to. So just because you sing, if you're not in fellowship, if you're not joined to God, you're not a Levite. And that's why Uzzah died, because he wasn't Levite. He wasn't the chosen people of God. And we're all Levites if we have that fellowship, if we have that relationship, if we're adhered or joined to him. So we must be in fellowship with God in order to minister effectively. All right, the last part I'm going to talk about is protocol in his presence, the steps for the Holy Spirit entering in. And I'll read this myself, reader, because I got another job for you in the meeting. All right. This one is Exodus 19 and 3. It says, and Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the children of Israel, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, these are instructions, y'all. If you will, indeed, obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words which you shall speak to the children of Israel. So Moses came and called for the elders of the people and laid before them all these words which the Lord commanded them. Then all the people answered together and said, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do. So he gave them instructions, and they said, we'll do it. So Moses brought back the words of the people to the Lord, and the Lord said to Moses, behold, I come to you in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with you and believe you forever. I don't know about y'all. I enjoy singing. I enjoy worship. But I really enjoy it when it is just, when God's presence is just there, like a cloud, when his anointing is there. And I get sad sometimes because I feel like, man, he's not coming. And I want it. I want to feel his anointing. Well, here's the steps to have that thick cloud. It says, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for the earth is mine. So number one, we need to obey his voice. When he tells us to do something, we need to do it. When he tells us we need to pray and fast before we get up and sing, we need to do it. When he tells us we need to get off Facebook, I'm guilty. We need to do it. When he tells us we need to quit watching so much TV, we need to do it. When he tells us, oh Jesus, get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and pray, we need to do it. Obey his voice. And the next one is like a little play on words.